Okay, good morning. Today is Thursday, October 15. Shu, meaning 15. And today we're going to continue reading of Chidakash Gita from Voice of the Self, from M.P. Pandit, from Nityananda's verses and speakings. And we're on page 26, the last line of the last verse of the last class of the top of page 26, his final comments, or in the last verse, he said, "Gaze into your heart, giving up all desire. With sight devoid of desire, look. Discard distinctions, burn up the idea of you and I." And so we're going to see that in the next set of verses that I'll read today and going on in the next few weeks, obviously. There's some core principles in his teachings that can be determined that will be repeated in different ways in many verses. One is a kind of radical equality of all appearance. Now, there's also a sharpened distinction between the outer and the inner, or the gross and the subtle. In one way, you can see a lot of dualistic, critics who like to criticize, or being critically minded, analyzing, we can see both a reaffirmation of essential distinction between outer and inner, or gross and subtle, or material and spiritual, or unimportant and essential. So there's a separation, but there's a combining. So separate and combine, right? Solve e coagula, like the alchemical. It's not necessarily evil. The evil ones take things, but before the evil ones took things, took principles and teachings, they were commonly used on the positive path, or used in the divine way. So dissolve and coagulate, break apart and put together. Make distinction and see unity. Make discernment, discrimination. Discrimination is a word people don't like to say, or I cringe when I say discrimination because everybody thinks that's racism or sexism or something. The original use of the word is not harming anyone or looking down on anyone, but actually discernment. To discriminate, to see clearly subtle differences, and particularly for spiritual path and spiritual teaching, we have to know what's essential and less important, what is to the long-term welfare and benefit and what is not, what helps greatly and what helps just a bit, what harms greatly and what harms just a bit, and then put together. And so that's what you're going to see a lot. And today we will get into some verses that are big. Like there's actually one of the verses, I think at the end of page 27, that is nearly two pages long without a break. And he just went on speaking, I assume, and they transcribed it, or they wrote it down. And we will start to see more clearly as we get deeper into these Gita songs, his utterances, how Mr. Scott is not Nityananda. And so I apologize, or I simply acknowledge that it's impossible for me to know deeply everything he says, because I'm not at that level of attainment. And I don't mean to be heretical, or that's not the word, actually. It's some kind of doing harm against a religious superior. But I'm just doing my best to try to understand what he said for you and me. And I think that's enough. And some of what he'll speak about is some of the intricacy of Kundalini Yoga and Pranayama Yoga. A lot of Sanskrit terms, and yet a lot of the Sanskrit terms he uses, or you'll see being used, have multiple interpretations. And I am not sure of which interpretation he means, and I'm not sure of the range of interpretations. And some of what he says is clearly understandable, and some is very difficult to understand. And that's why I initially didn't want to read Chidakash Gita. It was sort of the last matter for attention for public reading in my mind for many years. But it became clear as time went on that it would be fine to do so, given the proviso that some things he says I will misunderstand, some will, all, at best, will be partially explained. But if you use intuition, if you sit in meditation, deeper insight can come to everyone, to you, and to go beyond my limited understandings as well. So, his final point here, burn up the idea of you and I, and that's, again, of the way of reuniting. And so let's see how this principle of dissolve, of discernment and proper unification, wise discernment and careful recognition of unity, because it's not just combine, it's see the unity of, the pre-existing unity of. And much of it will be the outer, the inner, the gross, the subtle, the unimportant, the important, the material, the spiritual, what goes down and what goes up. And what goes up is what completes the seven chakra work, and what goes down keeps souls bound in third density. So, next utterance, and I'll just read these one at a time and then do commentary. In the beginning, one only was the religion promulgated by Shiva, or God. In the beginning, the distinction of man and woman obtained only in gross natures, meaning physical. In the subtle, there was none. They were one. The subtle has no quality, good or bad. The subtle sees only the eternal delight. Seeing and hearing are only delusions of the mind. There is nothing permanent in the world. So nothing permanent in the world of perceiving only the gross. And yet we can say that the nature of the gross is the subtle, or there's more to the reality of what appears than the appearance. His usage of the term subtle doesn't just mean inner eye or intuitive knowing. It also means non-physical reality or the metaphysical. So Ra said, the physical and the metaphysical are inseparable, meaning the apparent two is one. And yet to come to that, one must first know that they are two. And so proper solve, dissolving, and discernment doesn't mean break apart. It means see subtle distinction, subtle, gross, outer, inner, structure and function, activity and essence. By wise and careful discernment, which is akin to solve, at least in terms of comprehension, knowing distinction, then we come to a deeper ability to unify. So wise discernment precedes realization of essential unity. So when he says the subtle has no quality, good or bad, frankly, I can't say I know what he means. Cannot say, or I must say, I do not know what he means. The subtle sees only eternal delight, like Nityananda, endless ananda, or endless bliss. So eternal delight may well have been his, he used the word Nityananda when he was speaking before the translation to English. And so if he said the subtle sees only Nityananda, some people in the room think, what? Sees only you? And the translator may thought, people will think he's an egotist, or what the heck does he mean, the subtle sees only Nityananda? Yeah, he doesn't mean me. he means Nityananda as endless bliss or eternal delight. Maybe. And what does that mean? The subtle sees only endless bliss or eternal delight. I can't say. I've not experienced eternal delight. I've experienced temporary delight and bliss and non-duality and formlessness and incomprehensible profundity of all meaning and all importance, all, you know, all precious, similar to Ra saying the all sacred or hallowed and consecrate nature of everyday things. I've experienced that. But I don't really, maybe that's the subtle that I've only tasted, but I don't, you know, have any permanent abode in that subtle. But normally, subtle really means time, space, or the metaphysical, non-physical dimensions, or non-physical sight and knowing, which goes again back from manas to buddhi. So manas perceives and thinks on and conceives the gross, and buddhi acknowledges by wisdom or sees and knows the subtle. But that's still not the same as saying the subtle has no quality, good or bad. It's certainly true that beyond the dualism of what I like and what I don't like and what helps and doesn't help in time and space, right? That's the good and bad. What I like is good, what I don't like is bad. What helps me is good, what hurts me is bad. What is of value on the path is good and what's not is bad, sure. Yet there is no time and no space and no evolution from the perspective of non-duality. Now, is that what he means by the subtle? It may be. But it's also a common point in many traditions. In Taoism, they say the same thing, that before the rites and rituals, humans lived in accord with Tao naturally. And when they fell away, thereby was born rites and rituals and religions and laws. And all of that is a sign of a fall from grace. Same point, kind of point. So, going on, and this is the quote that'll conclude page 26. And again, hari is a word that has many meanings in Hinduism. And I think he really means hari as this world, or a portion of this world, or it is considered an aspect of this world, or jambudvipa. So, meaning the material or the gross. He said, Nityananda said, Hari is not the Lord, Shiva is the Lord. What is called Hari is Maya. The shadow is a delusion. The delusion of the fetters of Maya, delusion of the subtle and the delusion of the gross. The delusion of the gross and that of the subtle are the same. The delusion of the gross multiplies from moment to moment. It's a varied delusion. To hold this as separate from that is delusion. It is an illusion of your mind. Look rather to the delusion of the eternal delight, in Nityananda, in the heart. Look at the eternal self in the heart. Look, look, and again look. Look and speak what you have looked. Speak not what you have heard. Say, rather, what you yourself experience. What is heard is not eternal. What is heard is no true delight. The glory of experience, and experience is the ananda, or bliss. So again, solve, dissolve, discerning. There is gross, there is subtle, there is hari, there is Lord, there is Shiva, which is not hari, which is not the gross. However, from another level, he first distinguishes gross from subtle, hari from Shiva. Shiva's Lord, hari is not, hari is Maya. You can say that the gross or the physical, I mean, let's just say that hari is a stand-in for physicality or space-time, the so-called gross. The gross physicality, physical phenomenal experience, physical phenomena, is not Godhead. Godhead is Shiva, which is the subtle. Yet, there is, and so the outer gross, seeing it as the eternal, is a Maya illusion and a fetter. So delusion of the fetters of Maya, fetter binding people, is a delusion, however, of both the subtle and the gross. Both. There's the delusion of the subtle and the delusion of the gross. The delusion of the gross is presuming that the physical world is totality. The delusion of the subtle is presuming that it only is Godhead, and presuming that it is separate from, or eternally different, and not of the same true nature as the gross. So there's spiritual materialism and physical social materialism. Physical social materialism is, you know, salivation at the new watch. Ooh, it's a $5,000 watch. I feel my mouth is salivating. Or any sensual pleasure object, or social relations, and yeah, man, you got that promotion. Everyone will now look up to you. Now I can buy $500 leather shoes. There are people like that, you know. So the delusion of the gross seems to be the belief that the gross is totality and of supreme value, and there is no subtle. The materialism of the subtle, the delusion of the subtle, seems to be a hatred of the gross, and a notion that the gross, you know, never the twain shall meet. The subtle is superior, and the gross is disgusting only, and God is in the subtle but not in the gross, and the subtle and the gross, never the twain shall meet there. In enemies, my body is my enemy, the world is an enemy, those attached to the matrix are our enemies, Neo, something like that. Not realizing the identity of the gross and the subtle with their source. And so the delusion of the gross multiplies from moment to moment, but the delusion of the gross and the delusion of the subtle are the same. So spiritual bypassing, spiritual materialism, loving the high and hating the low, believing that God is in the temple and nowhere else. These are delusions. So to hold this as separate from that is delusion. So a delusion of the spiritual or subtle is that the subtle is not the gross. Huh? I thought you said they're different. Yeah, they are. From the perspective of getting free of delusions of the gross, one must know that there is a subtle. From the perspective of getting free of attachment to the subtle, one must know that ultimately all is one. And so there's no ultimate separation of this from that. To separate this from that, including the gross from the subtle, is delusion also. Illusion of the mind. Look rather to the delusion, so-called, of eternal delight in the heart. So rather than getting caught in materialism, nor caught in a kind of naive or suppressive and rejective spiritualism, spiritual materialism, spiritual bypassing, look to the joy in your mind. Look to the joy of your true nature. Look to joy. Look to find yourself. The moment contains love, said Ra. Find yourself. Don't worry about the outer, and don't worry about the inner. Find yourself. Don't worry about the gross and the subtle. Realize what you are. And then there's this more teaching on authenticity. Not only look to eternal delight in heart, or Chidakash, or eternal self in the heart. Don't be a fool, and don't be a fraud. Speak what you've seen. Don't speak what you've heard. Speak from experience, and don't be a poseur, a spiritual yogic poseur, and presume that your talk of enlightenment is enlightenment. Unless you've experienced, we don't know. Unless you've experienced, you don't know. Speak what you've experienced, and you know, be honest about these ideas seem right to me, but I haven't actually experienced ever bliss, or non-duality, or selflessness. And so the glory of experience and experience is bliss. So beyond gross and subtle. Top of page 27. Find out who you are. Find it out. Other is not the truth. Cultivate the samma. Now, samma may be same or equality. I'm not sure. Reach out to your core. Sense of distinction is not the truth. In your word shall be sameness. Burn up the physical sight and look. What causes suffering at the time of death is this sense of separateness. He may have been addressing one or several devotees' particular personal process in this verse, actually. But again, it's more talk on authenticity, and don't fake it. What you know, what you've experienced is what you can know. What you haven't experienced, you have to say you don't quite know. And even if we've experienced it, we only know some. excuse me. And again, while buddhi or inner sight or careful discernment, wisdom, I mean, there is a lot of discernment in wisdom. Yet, the sense of distinction is not the truth. So there's the truth of the distinction between gross and subtle. And the distinction, the seeing, one little phlegm, the seeing that the outer is not totality, that's a distinction. And yet, holding only to this, the distinction of the material and the spiritual, or the gross and the subtle, or the outer and the inner, or the lower and the upper, staying stuck there, one never realizes non-duality. And so, once you acknowledge the relativity, the relative value and importance and reality, the mayic illusory, relative illusory nature of the gross, burn up the physical sight and look. Look what? Look with the eyes of the subtle. Seeing what? Well, cultivate samma. The oneness, sameness, which is get beyond this very hard presumption, kind of a very deep mind presumption of differentness. There's this and there's that and there's the other and this and that and good and bad and up and down and I and that, I and you and pop, up, up. That's why Ra says self and other self. That is a statement of from non-duality. That beings are all the one self, and it's either this one or the other one. We have big wind today, and the great bamboo is shedding some old branches or old, I don't know what you call it, bamboo pole? I don't know the name of the trunk, bamboo trunks. Anyway, it's... You know, the seasons have their own logic, obviously, and so the winds of mid-autumn clear some of the stasis of summer and prepare the way for the rest phase, recuperative phase of winter, which prepares itself for the blossom coming forth of springtime, where there are winds as well. Spring winds end the winter and prepare for spring. The autumn winds conclude the summer and prepare for winter. And likewise, the rain, likewise, the sun do their work today to support what was born yesterday, what was seeded yesterday, born today, as preparation for tomorrow. So, anyway, now, page 27, not yet the massive quote, getting ready for that. So, mid-page 27, voice of the self, Nityananda said, seeing inequality is the upward breath at the time of death. It is impartite, I'm not sure what that word was, impartite, It is the light supreme, the subtle, the permanent. In the breath upward, so we're talking about upward breath, in the breath upward, there is no hiccup. This is, a breath upward is kundalini coming up. Breath meaning prana. In the breath upward, there is no hiccup. O Lord, O Shiva, harmonize the ingoing and the outgoing breath. That's pana apana, ana pana sati, ana pana, or ana apana, pana apana sati. This is Sanskrit or Pali for in breath or up, in breath, down breath, in breath, out breath, or incoming, outgoing, or in down and up, both. It's pretty much in, and I don't know what he might say, but I might say in and down, out and up. The incoming breath goes down. The outgoing breath goes up. We're talking about kundalini and prana here. There's physical breath coming in and out. There's pranic air going up and down. There's an up and down with both the in-breath and the out-breath, or the incoming and outgoing, actually. So, let me read it without interrupting. Seeing inequality is the upward breath at the time of death. Seeing inequality. It is impartite, or, I don't know. It is impartite, the light supreme, the subtle, the permanent, in the breath upward, there is no hiccup. Lo, O Lord, O Shiva, harmonize the ingoing and the outgoing breath. Laud, or praise. Laud in the head. Laud in the ocean of eternal joy. Laud in the Ida, Pingala, and the Sushumna nadis, the three channels in the back. O Kundalini of Ananda, bliss, rise. The match is in the box. The light is in the match. Rub the stick, light the fire. Darkness is ignorance, avidya. Light is knowledge. So it's actually darkness is avidya, light is vidya. Kundalini, and here it's not translated as kundalini, it's put, written as kundali. Kundali, that might be the root of kundalini. Kundali is eternal delight. Kundali is the eternal delight in the heart, right? Heart is Hridayakash, perhaps. Kundalini, or Kundali, is ablaze with the light of a million suns. Kundali is the light of the supreme, the light of the sun, the light of the subtle. Three are the nadis of Surya, and I think Surya is sun, Sushumna, central channel, of the moon, Pingala, of the stars, Ida. The nadi of the third eye is the nadi of jnana. Jnana means knowledge, very similar to vidya. So jnani is the knower, which can be the person on the path of jnana yoga, which is basically the path, it's commonly considered study, but as far as I know, so raja yoga as a meditative yogic path, Jnana Yoga as a study-based spiritual path, but the kind of knowing here is not book learning, obviously. It's knowing reality. And so Jnana is knowing, akin to the word knowledge. And again, we don't know the original words he's used in all cases, saying that light is knowledge may actually be light is Jnana. So, seeing inequality in equality, one sameness seeing, same as sama before. And so again, there is the three. There are the three channels that are associated with energy or breath upward, or kundali or kundalini, which is prana. Prana is the energy, the essential energy of all life, of all that circulates in all gross and subtle objects and people and phenomena. There's no gross and subtle phenomena without prana. And the path of self-transformation or perfection or move to mukti and moksha, liberation, salvation, Buddhist called unbinding or nirvana, the deathless, is akin to the path of the upward breath from root to crown. And while there can be said to be three major channels up the spine, etheric, non-physical, carrying prana or of prana, the central sushumna is more important, or at least is associated with awakening and perfection of the seven chakras, energy circuit from root to crown completed, or the ascent of kundalini to the crown, or the union of Shiva Shakti, Shakti, Kundalini, Kundalini Shakti up the spine, uniting in Brahmarandra, or seventh chakra, Shiva at the crown, at the top. And while that's a metaphysical process, the mental mental portion of it, like conduct and view, need much work too. And so Buddhism does not focus on the mechanical, the metaphysical mechanical, the mechanics of the metaphysical energetics, like kundalini or prana or yogic movement and activity and chakras. Buddhism focuses on conduct and view. Conduct, right conduct by restraint and right view, and right view by right practice, and right practice leading to freedom from all harmful tendency, as well as a perfection of the energy system. But it comes naturally in time, breaking the 10 fetters. So different conceptions of the path, but it's the same work. So again, the contrast between light and dark, and that the way of self-realization in Kundalini Yoga, as well as the goal of Advaita Vedanta, which as self-realization, realizing, you know, the union of Jivatman and Paramatman, is very much the practice. It comes very much in this tradition from the practice of harmonizing incoming and outgoing breath, which is upward and downward pranic movement in particularly the central channel. There's a nice phrase here: the match is in the box, the light in the match. Rub the stick, light the fire. So the match that generates the transformative element of fire. So the match is a physical phenomena, physical object, a physical object whose function is significantly the generation of the transformative element of fire. We may light my fire. We may light our own fire. Come on, baby, light my fire, said 1966 or so. You can still hear that song on YouTube. I think it's some guy. I forgot it, Jose, somebody. But that's a real classic. Come on, baby, light my fire. I mean, you really want to see what the 60s were all about, listen to that in black and white. So the match is in the box of the body, the box of the physical gross form, includes a match. The match is very much like the potentials of root chakra to generate an energy flow that reaches the crown center. Light is in the match. The light is in the fire, actually. The match struck generates fire. The heart of the fire is light. And when prana is struck, or the generation of pranic fire, the awakening of pranic fire, the direction of pranic fire from root to crown, brings the light of knowledge, of jnana. And that's the nadi of the third eye, the energy channel. Nadi is not chakra, it's an energy line or channel. The energy channel of the third eye is the energy channel of knowledge or vidya or jnana or realization, gnosis. It's not just knowing this and that, it's actually gnosis. Jnana is better translated as gnosis, or gnosis as essential spiritual knowing. So that's a process that we do when we're seeking love wisdom, whether we do pranayama or not. Now, to the massive utterance at the bottom of page 27. This one goes through the end of 27, all through page 28, and page 29 nearly to the bottom. So it's nearly two full pages. So let me read it all, and this may be the final verse for commentary today. So Nityananda said, bottom of page 27, knowledge, and this may be jnana, knowledge is in this nadi, energy channel. In this nadi is sleep. In this nadi is the sushupti. There is no wakefulness in sushupti. Get to this sushupti. Uniting the inward and outward breath, resort carefully to the subtle sleep. That's what we're talking about here is sleep, and sushupti as a subtle sleep. Uniting the inward and outward breath, resort carefully to the subtle sleep. See true delight, Ananda, in the inward and outward breaths harmonized. Attain to it. The seat of breath is the truth, sat. Within is the expanse of the sky, akash. Inside of it is the tower of eternal delight. This tower of eternal bliss, and again, I think it's Nityananda, this tower of eternal bliss is the seat of peace. Sleep consciously in the gross sleep, not the sleep of the beast, but have the sleep of man. Sleep which is the aim of life, sleep of consecration. So sleep as freedom from all lower functions of mind, unified in vidya and jnana. Sleep consciously in the gross sleep, not the sleep of the beast, but have the sleep of man, sleep which is the aim of life, sleep of consecration. Talking or sitting, sleep without ideas, without thoughts. Sleep placing the breath in sleep without any other objective. Do the japa, which is like mantric repetition or chanting. Do the japa of the inward and the outward breath. Cultivate bhakti, devotion, in the mind. Attain liberation. Have boundless bhakti. Confine the breath and draw it upward and downward. Right, pranayama. Drawing up the breath is rechaka, suspending it, holding it, is kumbhaka. This kumbhaka is your station, breath suspension or breath retention. Letting the breath down is puraka. So you've got three phases of breath practice, rechaka, kumbhaka, puraka, drawing it up or in, I think, up, maybe it's up and in, is rechaka. Holding it, retention is kumbhaka, and that this kumbhaka is your station. Letting the breath down or out is puraka. While breathing in, draw up as water from a well. Draw up the breath to the brahmarandra. Okay, so in-breath goes up. By this in-breathing and out-breathing, kindle the fire, kundalini. Purify all the nadis. Burn up the wind, bile, and phlegm in that fire. Deliberation is the fire, the yoga fire, the fire digestive in the stomach. The fire of deliberation is the luster of the sun. The universe is truly of the nature of the consciousness of the Supreme. But this world, as it appears, is a figment of the mind. Creation is an ideation of the mind. There is no creation to to the consciousness of equality in all. The subtle state is the same for all creatures, mobile and immobile. There is difference only in causation. Distinctions are a delusion. The difference is only in the bodies. The bodies are transient. The prakriti is of maya. To perceive the subtle in the gross is indivisible liberation. The indivisible without division is liberation. Liberation, mukti, is the sky of the heart. So liberation is hridayakash. In the heart is the Shivalingam, the self-existent. The chief prana is self-existent. And the chief is the upward breath, the pranavayu. What is as prana is as or is the one. What is as prana is the one. What exists also is one. To those who practice and see, it is one. For those who do not practice, there is only the experience of bondage. Withdraw desire from the bonds and attain liberation while living. Realize the truth. Turn the eye round and see the truth. He who so turns inward the mind, or citta, is the Purush. In him is the universe. He is in the universe. A mind involved in the world is not steady. What is steady is the Shiva in the heart. Shiva is the Omkara, Omkar, and Omkar is the form of Pranava. Pranava is what has form. Omkara is the dissociation of the bodily feeling. Omkara is all-pervading. Like the dawn of the sun is Omkara. Omkara is the witness of all. Omkara is the most frightful of forms. Omkara is Agni, fire. There is nothing superior to Agni. Agni is actually the god of fire. There is nothing superior to Agni in all the universe. All is Agni within and without. In the middle is the earth. Below is the earth. Above is the Vayu, or air. The Vayu is in the universe. The universe is in the Vayu. First is Vayu, second Agni. First is thought, second is sound. Soundlessness is in the form of Vayu, meaning silence. Soundlessness is eternal bliss. It is Satchitananda, Satchitananda. In soundlessness shall be merged yourself. All that is visible is the self. In the self, when chit and sat are joined, there is ananda, the ananda of discrimination, ananda of consciousness, ananda of Brahman, ananda of the supreme, the ananda eternal Satchitananda. That is manhood. That is knowledge of Brahman, knowledge of yoga, knowledge of time. That is the knowledge of the triple time in the heart. In the heart lies liberation, the liberation of eternal delight. So, a lot of points are made here. Initially, there's a discussion of sleep. Sleep doesn't mean lying in your bed, you know, unconscious to the world. Here, we're talking about yogic sleep, but he's not really talking about a certain practice. He's talking about freedom from the discriminative, dualizing mind. Freedom from the tyranny of manas. Freedom from the tyranny of manas. And Hinduism very much is a straight teaching on non-duality. I mean, that's why they call it Advaita Vedanta. So Advaita means not Vaita, means not two, not dual Vedanta. And getting beyond talk of gods is ultimate. Using the words of the gods and the various complex techniques of pranayama yoga, he's really encouraging the awareness of sama or equality. I mean, he said all here are God. You know, you are all gods. I mean, I think Jesus said something like that too. So the point is, all is one, and the one is the infinite creator, and therefore all beings are manifestations of the one infinite creator. All beings' truest, deepest nature, true nature, essential, core identity, most complete, identity without distortion, true nature without distortion, complete and whole and perfect nature of all beings is infinity, or the one. And knowing that is akin to sleep. And so knowing that, not just talking about it, knowing it, then talking about it, or knowing it. Here I'm talking about it. Maybe I've tasted it a bit, but I don't live in that. But living in that is akin to living asleep. But it's not stupid sleep or the sleep of a beast. It's not sleep of ignorance. It's the sleep of not making falsehood, not believing in Maya, not even recognizing a distinction, perhaps, of Maya and Sat or Vidya, beyond all illusory distinction, dualism, and then eventually work to do. Finishing all the work to do is being finished with duality, being finished with making two of what is one, and essentially making one out of what is infinitely, it is infinite and inconceivable. Even making one has to be dropped. And I'm sure he would understand that. I think that's true. So in this nadi, the nadi of jnana from the last verse, the nadi of the third eye, right, ajna chakra, the nature of consciousness in third eye is the jnana that he's speaking of, the consciousness of sixth ray, the mind of sixth ray, the quality of awareness associated with sixth chakra. Here is called knowledge, which is either vidya or jnana. At least he's clearly saying, they translated, they clearly put the word jnana. So it's gnosis, it's realization. Of what? Of oneness, which is what? Which is that while there is a gross and a subtle, all is one life. And all is dancing, vibratory form of light and color and sound and shadow that has an inconceivable true nature. And so talking about no wakefulness in sushupti, wakefulness doesn't, I'm not sure if he's using that in a negative way as contrasting with sleep, but he's certainly putting together teaching some very basic core teaching on pranayama practice, right? Breath yoga, prana yoga, pranayama practice, uniting inward and upward breath, resort carefully to the subtle sleep. The subtle sleep is the sleep of the monastic functions of mind that are ever discriminating and judging and dualizing. And so, and then there are states of samadhi where, I mean, I had this experience where I felt every single in-breath, I felt a surge of joy. It was very weird. I mean, I really felt every single in, for a certain period of time in that samadhi, every time I breathed in, I felt pulsed with joy. And it was like, hey, I'd like to stay here forever. But of course, it was about to end with that thought. But it was really quite remarkable. Resort carefully to subtle sleep, the sleep of the mind free of agitation and unhelpful or unhelpful discriminations. Now, that's not racist discrimination. That's all silly. It's actually the dualizing function and the judging and the functions of mind akin to manas or manasic function that obscure the union of the gross and the subtle and remain in some kind of basic spiritual ignorance by attachment. So the seat of the breath is sat, the seat of your breath. I mean, where does breath come from? Where does prana come from? It ultimately comes from Godhead or Creator or Source. And within the seat of breath is truth or sat, and that's where you'll find bliss. And that's where he goes regularly explaining Satchitananda, that when chit is in sat, there is ananda. When chit or consciousness, let's say, is in sat or truth or reality, because it's really what truth? It's the truth of reality as it is beyond mental overlay, beyond conceptualization, without fourth skanda sankharic fermentations, without volitional compounds and overlay, without affirmation and negation. Let's hear Nagarjuna's portion. Beyond affirmation and negation is beyond manasic function. The buddhi is free. His understanding of buddhi, I think, would be associated with mind knowing beyond conceptual affirmation and negation. Not saying it is, but knowing what is. Not saying it isn't, but knowing what is. Saying or not saying, but knowing. There is the union of chit and sat. Awareness or consciousness, you know, starting with self-consciousness or subjective consciousness, sat. We go to universal awareness, chit. So chit as awareness or chitta, like chittakasha. Chit as awareness or consciousness starts with subjective consciousness and goes to transpersonal universal awareness, chit. When it goes out of the subjective to the universal, we're talking about knowing sat, which is so-called truth, but it's very much like Dhamma or Dharma too, but it's not a thing, it's not an idea. It's the truth that reality is as it is, independent of conception, independent of affirmation and negation. That's the point. You can affirm and you can negate, have a good time, but actually reality is what it is. You are all dancing thoughts, said Ra, right? The illusion of limits, the concept of light. So even light, the substance of form and the substance of thought, or the basis of thought as light, is an illusion, is a concept. So all that appears limited is illusory, or that appearance of limitation is illusion. And it's basically established by light, intelligent energy, which is prana, which is itself illusory or conceptual as well. The creation, the apparent substantiality of creation is illusory because it's a concept in the mind of the creator. It's the appearance of finity, which is ultimately just Godhead dreaming, like California dreaming. It's Godhead dreaming, dreaming the octaves. You know, Godhead California dreaming, 1970, Southern California beaches, very special, very golden sun. It's logoic dreaming, the illusory, conceptual, vibrational, and yet essentially divine, multidimensional display of light. So, sleep consciously in the gross sleep, not the sleep of an animal, but the sleep of man. And many spiritual teachers in India, in Hinduism, Buddhism, commonly frame the spiritual path as the path of the hero or the true man, woman, man, whatever, gender, but it really means a person, a mind, a being, a human being is not a true man. Anthropos, or man as the root of manas, man as the root of mind, the fivefold mind that can live like a beast and also go beyond all the gods. That is the nature of man. And so the true man, or human, the fulfillment of the human promise, is to be a completely awakened being. And so then he goes into sleep, which is the aim of life. Oh yeah, well that's the slackers' motto. Sleep is the way they live, but not, he doesn't mean that sleep. Sleep of consecration, talking or sitting, sleep without ideas, without thoughts. And that explains it very clearly. Freedom from discursive mind, a mind resting in equanimity. Hey, samatha, samadhi, upekka, equanimity. Right? Samatha is tranquility. And samadhi is calm abiding, or peaceful mind, concentrated, clear, you know. Non-grasping attentiveness, sati. Mindfulness, sati, anapanasati. Sati is the practice that leads to samadhi and equanimity, upekkha, and shamatha, you know, tranquility, and a relative sleep, you know, spiritual sleep, that sees and can knows, but is not caught by endless discriminations, endless discernings, or endless monkey-minded jumpings and thinkings. Sleep, placing the breath in sleep, without any other objective. Place the breath in sleep. Some of what he's teaching, he's talking about are subtle practices, which he probably explained to anyone in the room if they asked after this. Do the japa of the inward and outward breath. It's a very interesting reformulation of the term japa. Japa beads, like little seeds of certain tree seeds as bracelets for mantra practice. Do the mantric repetitions of inward and outward breath. That's enough japa. You don't have to do it with sound or deity praise, but there's also the inward and outward breath. Inward means coming in, outward means going out. It does seem that the inward goes up and the outward goes down, but they can be reversed. Depends on the practice. Cultivate bhakti or devotion in mind, attain liberation. Attain liberation by way of devotion to your practice, devotion to seeking the goal, devotion to the guru, for the purpose associated with a devotion to complete attainment. Have boundless bhakti. Confine the breath, draw it upward and downward. That's straight up pranayana practice and not Buddhism, at least not Theravada Buddhism. Then there's the bringing it in and holding it and putting it out. And this is specific practice, but would need much more. And people can get into big, big trouble doing pranayama practice alone or without a teacher, or carelessly, without adequate study, preparation, understanding. So then we've got the whole notion of fire. Fire is actually very interesting. In the sequence of elements, commonly it's earth, water, fire, air. Third chakra related to fire. Fourth chakra related to air. The transmutation of water, earth, is by fire to air. Air is vayu, fire is agni. And so the lower, or the gross, is burned up or transmuted into the higher vayu, which is ultimately ether and then associated with higher quality prana or pranic flow, by fire. Fire is the transformative element from the bridge from lower to higher. Fire is critical. And in theosophy, there's a whole set of teachings about Agni Yoga. It's basically conceptual, but it's very interesting. Agni Yoga from, I never got into it. Only certain certain unusual people get into Agni Yoga studies, but they're very, there's probably a lot of deep truth there. So so the practice of moving to sleep and freeing oneself ultimately from uncontrolled manasic function, and that means also lower chakra blockage, and that also means neurosis and obsessions and compulsions and mistaken assumptions and distorted beliefs of self and distorted desires and various aspects of grasping, aversion, ignorance, or the three unwholesome roots, all of the ashravas and effluence and the cankers and the kleshas. So the kleshas and the ashravas, asavas, ashravas, kleshas, all the distorted karmic biases and distorted preferences and countless tendencies of desire and aversion need to be burned up. And the burning up is basically clearing lower chakra blockage. It's the same. And that can be done by pranayama practice, although people can get into big trouble with it. It's also done simply by paying attention to conduct and view and spiritual practice. Sila, samadhi, prajna on the Buddhist way. Same, same. All right. Particularly sila and samadhi do the work of lower triad blockage clearance, clearing the lower three chakras blockage, which is also called self-healing or healing and balance. Healing by way of balance, the balance of the wisdom and the development of those higher qualities of mind associated with love and wisdom, fourth and fifth chakra, as the way of clearing the lower three. There's a lot of danger when you use forcing techniques to clear pranic blockages, pranic nadi blockages, and chakra blockages, and nadi obstruction, and seek to force kundalini or prana from root to crown. A lot of people get into trouble, and I would never recommend it. But that's a pranayama yoga versus Buddhism or anapanasati or sati mindfulness as a way of burning up the lower chakra blockages or releasing the blockages and burning up earth and water to turn into ether or air. It's safer and a little bit more peaceful and doesn't require exactly the same relation of a guru as this type of teaching. But it could be, Buddhism could be called Raja Yoga, going from Sila, Samadhi, Prajna, virtue, ethics, morality, right restraint, right speech, action, conduct, livelihood, Sila, supporting meditation, Samadhi, on to Prajna, wisdom, insight, awakening, release. It's a different conceptualization of path from Buddhism to his kind of pranayama yoga Advaita Vedanta. But the goal is the same, I have no doubt. The universe is truly of the nature of the consciousness of the Supreme, right? So all creational phenomena is Godhead. Yeah. But this world, as it appears, is a figment of mind. And so the appearance of the world is not separate from Godhead or Satchitananda, in the sense that reality is not broken by the physical gross appearance or God, all is one, and therefore there's nothing outside of the one infinite creator or Godhead or divinity, whatever that means, or source. Source as perfection and whole. There's nothing outside that. There's nothing bad, actually. But to see it, to only see it the way we see it, is a figment of the mind or illusion. To see the gross as only the gross, or the gross as the all, is Maya. To see the gross as a cover of the subtle, and as another face of the divine, is a little bit less Mayic. But again, you know, we can talk, but it's better to talk what we have experienced, and I haven't fully experienced the union of the gross and the subtle. There is no creation to the consciousness of equality in all. Eh? Creation is an ideation of the mind. So the world as it appears is a figment of the mind, but it's not outside of the divine. Creation is ideation of the mind, but it's still not outside the divine. Or it's not outside Godhead or perfection. And its nature is the subtle. The nature of the gross is the subtle, and the nature of the subtle is boundlessness, is infinity. The subtle state is the same for all creatures, mobile and immobile, he said. There's difference only in causation. Yeah, so causes lead to different form or different consequences. Different cause, different consequence. And the consequences are shown by the differentiation of forms and phenomena and beings. Bodies are transient. That prakriti is sort of elemental force, or elementals. The nature of the gross is of Maya. But to perceive the subtle in the gross is indivisible liberation. Okay, so yes, there's the gross, but one can perceive the subtle in the gross, or one can perceive, the jewel in the lotus. Om Mani Padme Hum. Mani Padme is the jewel in the lotus. The jewel in the lotus is the subtle, akin to the subtle in the gross, the divine in the profane, the sacred in the profane, the sacred nature of the profane, the infinite nature of all that appears finite and transient. At the beginning of the movie Dead Man, there's a quote on that. So, let's see. Oh, we got to end here. So, towards the end of this long statement, again, a couple of points of guidance as he's given, as always. To those who practice and see, it is one. And so, it is one, meaning the oneness of the gross and the subtle. And while you can attain that by careful working with pranavayu, prana, energy, wind, or air, the energy within the element of air, one doesn't need that. So what is as prana is the one, what exists also is the one, everything is one. To those who don't practice, there's only the desire, the experience of bondage, right? And so liberation is an unbinding, Buddhism, unbinding, deathless. So complete and perfect enlightenment is an unbinding and a liberation from bondage. The bondage of wrong view, the bondage of self-harm, the bondage of ignorance, the bondage of suffering and dukkha. So withdraw desire from the bonds and attain liberation while living. Again, I think very few people know how much is involved in that. And it's a count infinitely more easy to say than do. Realize, turn the eye around and see the truth, right? So much of spiritual practice and spiritual perspective and the spiritual life or spiritualization of mind is focusing awareness on the seer, not simply the so-called outer and seen. See the seer. Let the seer see itself, then the seer will find its nature. You know, see yourself and you'll know yourself. But if you keep looking outside, you'll lose yourself. right? What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his self? And so lose his soul. So gain the outer, lose the inner essential, seek the inner and the essential, and one can master the outer if one has any interest in it, or at least one can work well in the outer. In him, he who so turns the mind is the Purush, Sat Purush. Purush is like person. Sat Purush is true person. Another term can be for Atman, another term for Logos, or Paramatman in the Atman, or, you know, the true nature of Jiva, soul, reincarnating is Atman. So when that's known, we have Jivatman. Sixth density, you know, union with higher self or that condition. Then one, that entity evolves through the octave to eighth density, becomes one with Paramatman, or Logos. And that's Purush. Sat Purush is the Logos, actually. In him is the universe. He is in the universe. He is the universe. A mind involved in the world is not steady. The world is the all in Buddhism. And freedom is freedom from this all. Then Shiva is Omkara. Omkara, again, is like the karma or karma of Om. The Om making. Which is really letting there be light, speaking the Logos as the word, as the being that speaks the word, and the word itself. And the God was with the Logos, and the word was with God, and the word was God. So the word, like Omkara, or Om, being spoken is Omkara. So the speaking of Om is Omkar, or Omkara. The nature of that Om is its source, is the one who speaks the Om, which is, you know, Parabrahman, Paramatman, Godhead, Source, Intelligent Infinity. What is steady is Shiva in the heart, and Shiva in the heart is Omkara, and so there's the linkage between heart and then heart space or heart field, Hridayakash, close to Chittakash, same, really. Hridayakash is in Chittakash, or they're really not so different. It's the heart-mind, right? Chittakash is Hridayakash, as far as I can tell, whether it's in the physical heart or in the third eye. Because the fully enlightened being, or at least the one who dwells in sixth chakra and all the other chakras are fully developed or maximally developed, has no distinction between sixth chakra and fourth. The qualities of fourth chakra, fourth and fifth, love, wisdom, is fully unified in the full development of sixth ray. So, anyway, he also says Omkara is Agni, and that's very, very interesting, meaning there's a burning quality, fire, to the Omkara itself. And so the universe is not a static field of multidimensional light. It's actually a shimmering tapestry that has certain qualities of fire. It's self-transmutation, self-transmuting. Multidimensional octaves have a self-transmutational quality. The nature of light itself is self-transformative. Is of continual transubstantiation. So prana is intrinsically self-transforming. That's actually the basis of consciousness. I mean, consciousness itself is a reaction to light's reflective activity, or light's reflective activity gives rise to consciousness. So, if you know what I mean. So Vayu is in the universe is in Vayu, it just goes on and on and on, and the time as well. So take a look, you know, there's much more to say just on this one massive utterance verse that ends in the middle of 29, and it's lovely and extremely rich spiritual teaching here. So check it out for yourself. First is thought, second is sound, and soundlessness is in the form of the wind or air. Mm-hmm. Soundlessness is eternal bliss. So Nityananda is soundlessness, even though he did a lot of talking here. So with that said and unsaid, let's call it a day. Next time we'll pick up at the beginning, at the end of page 29. I hope you enjoyed this. Thanks to all involved. Please take good care of yourselves, and good night.